Looks reasonable. No, white can play e3, takes, takes. Okay, so what do you have there from white's point of view? He has a free game, black surrendered the center. But black has the two bishops and there's some exchanges. And even if black's position is a little bit cramped, but he doesn't have the two knights that would get in the way of the bishops. It's easier to tolerate, you know, a cramped position when you have less pieces, right? So here, you know, maybe white has a minuscule, you know, advantage, but not really a whole lot. So I expected him to play. Suddenly, he played this. Now, I never seen this before, and frankly, you know, I didn't have a high opinion of this move. It looked very suspicious to me. And after I checked, you know, the databases on my computer, I couldn't find a single game that went this way. So we uncharted territory, but this move is logical, right? So he wants me to take, we exchange everything. Now he has the freedom for his bishops, and he has 3-2, maybe potential queenside pawn majority. How do I fight against this? What do I do?
D5.
Yeah. Obvious. Very good. Well, I mean, I couldn't possibly thought that when I didn't see D5, because D5 is the only move anyone would look at this situation. What does white accomplish by playing D5? First of all, how to put it? I formulated this before many times, but always somewhat in different way. Anyways, here is. When you're given a choice of different plans, a lot of people don't know which one to follow. Like, you know, should I play an isolated pawn? Should I, you know, this or that, you know? Well, those things, it's hard to decide. Whereas there is one thing, you know, that might help you make a right decision. You basically try to operate with what you have. You have already given up your dark square bishop for a knight, meaning that your play is likely to be developed on light squares. This is where you get control. If he takes, knight takes. See how your knights sit on the light squares? And, you know, obviously, you know, you have threats immediately, so it's unlikely to happen. But in general, and this pawn, it's on a dark square. It would prevent his pieces from coming out. So you want to leave his pawns on dark squares. For example, in this situation, the same move immediately comes to mind, because you leave that pawn on c5, where it's blockaded, and where it's basically an obstacle on the path of the knight or the bishop. So the same approach here. So white, the right plan for white is to fight for the light square domination. No, well, now he plays this.
Question?
Yeah.
Why not to c5?
In reply to this,
oh, I see the fork.
I could probably go knight e4.
Yes, because the queen then back to e7, push the pawn again to.
But then again, I'm not quite sure. You know, that's the best move. Because can play queen g6 here. Possibly, but I'm not sure about this. But anyway, you know, suppose, you know, you made your point and I play this. I want to keep this, you know, and I just don't know if the bishop is really that positioned that well on c5. It's going to be hit sooner or later, you know, with knight e4. Although I did consider bishop c5.
It's threatening mate or close to mate.
No, well, yeah, that's always a plus, you know, so.
Close to me.
When you're given a choice of intricate, you know, positional maneuvers, you know, things such as threat of checkmate and one should never be overlooked. You know, obviously, you know, should.
You wouldn't worry about b5 at all.
B5 at this point, probably not. You know, so there are. My main idea is that I can place the knight here. Now I think I get more of this. I force this pawn to do something. So I get the important thing, which is to take on d5 with a piece, either knight or a queen. I think that would work out quite well for me. No, the simple development, because I'm having this issue. Okay, so what do I want to do? What, suppose, you know, I just want to get like a structural advantage out of this. If he recaptures this way, now maybe I'm happy because I split his pawns. And now I just have to catch up in development because I spent too much time walking around with that knight. So I play e3, bishop e2, castles, and now I don't mind some exchanges. Put my rook on c1 and try to attack this pawn. Nice, actually quite easy to play for white. Well, there is a little problem here that he takes with the queen. Now I'm not quite sure. One move, you know, that really stands out here, the move I wanted, I calculated during the game. Because if I let him castle, you know, he'll probably. He also kind of slowed down my development with this pressure with the queen. But one move really stands out, the move you want to play. Huh?
E4, queen
d5.
Yeah, there is queen d5. Yeah.
He's attacking your knight on c4,
yeah.
So you have to.
Queen d5 was one move. No, okay, and then back to this, yeah, back to the same thing, you know. So I'll get the. I'll probably split his pawns, you know. I doubt he's gonna take. Because that would be hard for him, you know, to. But another move, you know, I would say that this kind of stands out, you know, to play knight d5. Because you don't know if it's. You cannot castle and you have threats, but. I looked a little bit at this variation. Now, obviously, I go rook c1. So I'm going to win the rook on a8, but the question is if my knight will come back. Very strange, you know, after I looked at this move, I discarded the whole line. Suddenly I realized that it's not only the knight, you know, it's my king, you know. Well, I forgot to evacuate my king. It only takes him one move, bishop takes pawn, to clear the b4 square and cause me big problems here. I may be able to defend against this, but then I might lose the knight. So in order not to lose the knight, I probably have to keep the queens on the board. But if I keep the queens on the board, I'm going to get mated before him. So, nah, that was a bad choice. No, indeed, the queen d5 would be the best move. Yeah. No, well, I guess what affected me in this situation was the ease with which I reached this favorable position. I didn't really have to work for it. You know, in two moves. You know, I got this, and maybe I became too greedy. Maybe indeed, simply go into stabilizing the position and go into the end game right away. Maybe would be the best. Possibly would be the best decision here. I played this move, so I thought, let me reinforce my pressure. You know, by putting the bishop. Fianchetto, the bishop on one diagonal. And I thought, if I take too early, then he can jump out with his bishop to a6. So I thought.
Leave the pressure, leave the tension.
Yeah, that's, you know, it's a very attractive move, g3, you know, really. But he quickly answered with this.